Pluto must become a planet again. Think of Pluto and its tumultuous history. A celestial object first imagined and fervently desired until it was forcibly removed from the sky, then celebrated as a new triumph of mathematics, but later diminished and denied, forced to confess to an insignificant mass, and finally marginalized and reduced to the lone leader of a herd of asteroid buffaloes in the far west of the solar system. Imagine a planet as American as John Wayne himself, even discovered by a young farmer-astronomer from Kansas, one of the many rednecks of the Great Plains, suddenly called upon to confront a geometric and deceitful god who's throwing the dice 6 billion kilometers away. Just a dot of light at the time, but a dot that we now know to be a fairy tale world, extraordinarily complex, with numerous moons and plains and mountains in constant mutation. In 2015, Pluto finally revealed its true nature as a small world, peripheral but dominant in this orbital region, a desolate province where, for almost a century, all our dreams as Earthlings in search of mysteries have been deposited. But the short-sightedness, if not the malice, of some scientific circles still keeps it in the fictitious and ridiculous underworld of the dwarf planets. And here we are once again, challenging this decision and demanding justice. Justice for Pluto, a lovable planet that we have come to love. A new world in our skies, read the big headline in the Chicago Daily Tribune. It was a Friday in mid-March, 1930. Ninth planet discovered at edge of solar system. First in 84 years, read the front page of the New York Times that morning. And since that day, for more than 70 years, we've been taught in school about a nine-planet solar system. There were our neighbors, Mercury, Venus, and Mars. A little further on was Jupiter with its streaks, then Saturn with its majestic rings, followed by the azure pearls of Uranus and Neptune. And then there was the dimensionless speck of light that, after years of searching, had caught the attention of Clyde Tumba, the 24-year-old Kansas farmer-astronomer who, for $90 a month, found himself scanning the skies at Flagstaff's Lowell Observatory. They called it Pluto, the solar system's last outpost, so distant and isolated that it would be visited by an interplanetary probe only 85 years after its discovery, on July 14, 2015, the last of the planets. In fact, 26 years after Voyager 2's flyby of Neptune, the U.S. New Horizons probe passed so close to Pluto that it could finally show its face as a real planet, a frontier planet. A probe that, by the way, had already left Cape Canaveral on January 19, 2006, for a journey that would take more than 9 years along a 5 billion kilometer route. Except on August 24th of the same year, when the probe had been on its way for only 7 months, Pluto was killed. A crime foretold. In fact, it had already been clear for some years how the increasing number of objects discovered beyond Neptune was repeating the situation in which 19th century astronomers had found themselves when, after the discovery of Ceres, hailed as the missing planet in the sequence of distances predicted by Titius-Bone's law, they soon found themselves buried by the subsequent discoveries of dozens of other planets orbiting between Mars and Jupiter, so that it became a game to call them minor planets, or more inaccurately, asteroids. However, the event that led to the defenestration of Pluto was undoubtedly the discovery in January 2005 of the object we now know as Eris, defined at the time as the 10th planet of the solar system. This discovery panicked the astronomical community, which, accustomed to the idea of a very neat and tidy classical solar system, feared that it would be faced with the chaotic handling of dozens of companion planets to Pluto. And the 26th General Congress of the International Astronomical Union, to be held in Prague in August, seemed just the time to address this terrible problem once and for all. Something had to be done to stop the illegal immigration of hundreds, perhaps thousands, of supposed planets from the Kuiper Belt. And so, amidst fear clashes between opposing factions of the 400 astronomers present at the conference, a motion was prepared outlining the three characteristics that an object in the solar system must have in order to be called a planet. A, it must orbit the Sun. B, it must have sufficient mass so that its self-gravity overcomes the rigid body forces so that it assumes a nearly spherical shape of hydrostatic equilibrium. C, it must have cleaned up the region in which it travels in its orbit. Only if it possesses all three of these characteristics can an object deserve the title of planet, while if it lacks the third characteristic, it must be considered a dwarf planet. For all other cases except satellites, we must speak of small bodies of the solar system. And of course, the large number of objects orbiting Pluto led to its rapid exclusion from the aristocratic club of planets. Someone makes a last-ditch effort to save the only American planet by suggesting that the term planet could include both classical planets, from Mercury to Neptune, and dwarf planets, Pluto, Ceres, Eris. But the attempt is in vain. However, the vast majority of the assembly votes, by show of hands in the opposite direction. The term dwarf planets in Resolution 5A does not refer to a normal subcategory of planets, but to a separate and entirely different category. Some point out that, from a linguistic point of view, the term dwarf is still just a qualitative adjective of the term planet. But there's nothing to be done about that. Pluto and the others are gone forever. Astronomer Owen Gingrich, president of the assembly, made a significant comment. "This decision puts us in the absolutely ridiculous situation of not admitting that a dwarf planet is still a planet." "God always saves us from decisions made by a show of hands," wrote Mark Twain. But with this ill-advised decision, a not insignificant part of the last 100 years of astronomical history was erased, beginning with the visionary frenzy of Percival Lowell, continuing with the extraordinary observational experience of Tomba, and culminating in a popular consensus that made Pluto, along with Mars, the very icon of planetary science. There was no planet more planet-like than Pluto in the scientific imagination that is usually invoked in such cases. Well, one might say, but such a painful choice must surely have been motivated by superior classification needs, by a rethinking of the concept of planet capable of redesigning the framework of planetary knowledge, according to a more rational, more convenient to use, and above all capable of unambiguously incorporating future discoveries. Hey guys, just a moment before we continue, be sure to join the Insane Curiosity channel. Click on the bell, you will help us to make products of even higher quality. Someone might respond to this by saying, "No way. The great cultural loss has been repaid with a classification that is not useful at all, but only a source of confusion." In practice, according to the IAU, the point is to distinguish whether or not an object has cleared its orbital zone. But this distinction does not help to differentiate the objects in terms of their physical properties, but only, and incompletely, in terms of their dynamics. What could two dwarf objects like Ceres and Pluto have in common? Absolutely nothing. And is there perhaps something in the term dwarf planet that immediately indicates what we're talking about: origin, consistency, distance? Nothing, except a vague and arbitrary reference to size. Yet there is a pretense of passing off this new classification as rational. Okay, so we got rid of Pluto, but different planets like Mercury and Jupiter continue to coexist in the same class. What additional information has this new classification provided? At least the previous one could have the excuse of being the result of a historical and cultural process, and not the choice dictated by a scientific criterion. And as for the system's ability to accommodate future discoveries, is there anyone who can explain what will happen if, let's say, an Earth-sized object is found 150 astronomical units from the Sun, as seems possible? Will we call it a dwarf just because it is surrounded by debris? And as for this, no one has stopped to consider that it is one thing to clear a zone that is at most 1 to 2 astronomical units wide, as in the case of the so-called classical planets, and another to expect an object to clear a zone that is 10 to 20 astronomical units wide, as in the case of objects located in regions with very long orbital periods. Between Mercury and Jupiter, at a distance of less than 5 AU, there are 5 planets and each of them had to sweep a zone of about 1 AU. In addition, they can't count on fast orbital periods. Are these the same conditions we find for the objects orbiting beyond Neptune? Certainly not, since in those regions the orbital periods are measured in hundreds of years, and the distance between orbits, for example between Pluto and Eris, there is an average of about 27 AU, is measured in tens of astronomical units. Two different standards. That's why the criterion doesn't convince us. A simple question would suffice to make the whole thing ridiculous. If Earth magically found itself in Pluto's orbit, would it cease to be a planet? And anyway, if we're talking about orbital clearing, what about Jupiter being forced to coexist with a swarm of Trojan asteroids? And if we want to make a distinction in the size of planets, distinguishing between planets and dwarf planets, why not do the same with the gas giants? We can argue that gas giants are not planets because they have no surface on which to land. Or not. Or that Uranus is not a planet because its axis of rotation is not vertical, but on the plane of the ecliptic. Or that Venus is not a planet because it rotates clockwise, unlike all the others. And moving on to other areas, if tiny Malta is considered an island, just like Greenland, why can't Pluto be a planet? And should the stars, defined as red dwarfs or brown dwarfs, etc., no longer be considered stars? Who said that a body has to belong to only one group? Why can't a celestial body be both a planet and a dwarf planet? After all, to understand a human being, another life form, or an inanimate object, you have to look at all the different elements and try not to reduce the information to a single formula. The only possible solution would have been to continue with a bit of common sense and leave attributes such as small, giant, gaseous, and terrestrial type to better specify what type of planet was being discussed. Today we might have 100 planets, some giant and gaseous, others terrestrial type, and still others about all the large objects beyond Neptune, Kuiper, or Kuiperian. In this way, we would have avoided the villainy of demolishing an astronomical monument without reason, and the future embarrassments that are sure to come when we have to deal with other discoveries in the solar system and beyond. For all this and much more, we find the words of Alan Stern, planetologist and leader of the New Horizons mission, who upon hearing the news of Pluto's downgrade declared, "It's a ridiculous decision." There is also another aspect that came to light only after the unfortunate 2006 decision, and that is the success of the New Horizons mission, which revealed to us that Pluto is not at all a useless, fat, bald, and buttered asteroid, but an enigmatic world with towering mountains of ice, vast nitrogen-ice plains, an atmosphere and a climate, a thick icy outer shell, and a subsurface liquid water ocean, all on a solid rocky interior, and a satellite system consisting of 5 moons. So folks, we ask you, how do we label a 2,400 kilometer diameter body that is large enough to undergo planetary processes such as the formation of a molten core, persistent volcanism, and even the presence of an atmosphere? And if all this is not enough to bring you to our side, know that we have in store for you a cosmogonic argument that will convince you of the good right of Pluto, and also of Eris, to be part of the solar system as the 9th and 10th planets on an equal footing with all the others. A demonstration, however, which requires a minimum of mathematical treatment, and which we will therefore publish in a video, only if many of you request it.